John Caldera, welcome. I'm also the devil's advocate. I do this show. Anyway, you know all about that. Later on in the program, a look at the state song. Do you know where the Columbines grow? There's more to it than you might think. But first, higher education. How subsidized is it? Is it time to subsidize it more? From my alma mater, the University of Colorado in Boulder, law professor Paul Campos. Good to see you again.
Good
to be here.
It's
been a while.
Yeah, it's been a while.
You still publishing, writing your column?
Yeah, I write for various journalistic publications as well as my academic stuff. So look for me in better newspapers everywhere.
Did you miss the Rocky Mountain News?
Yeah, I do miss it. It's sad.
We all miss it.
Yeah, it's been about 7 years now.
Yeah, it just doesn't have the same feel in town without two papers.
No, it's sad.
All right. You teach law up at the University of Colorado in Boulder, which actually is a pretty decent law school, despite you working there.
Yes, amazingly.
Yeah. And it's expensive to go to this school. It's expensive to go to undergrad. And I keep hearing that we need to spend more money on higher education, that we're not putting enough money, particularly on a state level, into higher ed. And I remember years ago with referendum, see, the idea was we gotta make education more affordable. We need to subsidize higher ed. It hasn't been keeping up the amount of money that the state puts out. You did a piece for the New York Times that took it in a little bit of a different direction. How much money are we spending in higher education, and is it really subsidized enough?
Well, we're spending an enormous amount of money. If you look at government subsidies overall, both state and federal, we're spending more now per capita in real dollars than we ever have before. And that's just in direct subsidies.
All right, say that again, because that seems like such the wrong thing. It doesn't feel like we're spending more money than ever subsidizing higher education.
Yeah, well, we are. I mean,
that's not what I've heard.
That's true, but you're hearing a very partial story. I mean, the subsidies come in basically three major forms. One is state appropriations, which are down about 15% in real dollars from their peak. That's true.
When was their peak?
Their peak was about 2007. So they haven't quite recovered from the effects of the Great Recession, which of course led to great, you know, reductions in state tax appropriations. So those are about 15% down from their peak. But on the federal level, we're spending way more than ever in direct appropriations, both in the form of Pell Grants and especially in the form of tax credits, which essentially are payments from taxpayers directly to higher institutions.
Explain that a little bit, because I hear, maybe because I'm so tied into state government, I keep hearing we're not spending enough in the outlay to higher education, that the state is not giving enough money to our state-run institutions.
Right.
You're saying, yeah, there's some truth to that, but it's more than compensated from what's coming in other areas. Explain the tax credit.
Well,
from the feds.
A tax credit is different from a deduction. You know, when you get a deduction, you can deduct that amount from your income tax rate. And therefore, if you're paying like a 25% effective rate, that would mean that the deduction reduces your taxes by some, you know, small percentage of that. But a credit works like this. Suppose you pay $10,000 in tuition to State U, and you paid at least $10,000 in federal income taxes. There's a $2,500 tax credit that you get from the federal government, which means you get $2,500 off your $10,000 federal tax bill. In effect, that's $2,500 that's going not from you to State U, but from the taxpayers to State U.
So in other words, I've got a bill for my kid. It's 10 yeah. grand. I pay the 10 grand to the University of Colorado, but the feds give me in hard, cold cash $2,500.
That's right.
So really, I'm only giving $7,500.
You're paying CU or whoever $7,500, and the feds are paying the school $2,500. That's a straight subsidy, and that's just as much a subsidy as a state appropriation.
And that's coming from the feds, but we don't talk about that on the state level. Why not?
Well, we don't talk about it on the state level because, for one thing, it's a relatively complex subject, and people don't look at the larger picture. I mean, when you're talking about government appropriations, you should be looking at government appropriations. And what I did in the Times piece is try to look at the bigger picture. I also wrote a piece in the Atlantic that does so more comprehensively, to try to answer the question, are we spending less money in government public funds on higher education, both public and private, than we have before? And the answer is no. We're spending more money on higher education now in government money, in inflation-adjusted dollars per student going to school than ever before.
This is shocking even to me, and I'm pretty skeptical to begin with, mm-hmm. that we're spending more per kid than mm-hmm. ever before. And that's yeah. not maybe not be on the state level, but when you add it all together, state and federal. And you said there's basically three pots. There's the state outlay, there's a federal credit, and what else?
Pell Grants. Pell Grants, which more people are familiar with, are straight federal grant payments to students that are based on economic need. Which are essentially going directly to the school. Because when a student gets a Pell Grant, the Pell Grant is distributed to the school, then the school distributes it to the student if there's anything left over from the student's cost of attendance. Usually there isn't, which means that the school just keeps it, which means that the Pell Grant, of course, is going directly to the school.
So in other words, I can get tax credit for my kid. My kid can get a Pell Grant, which is direct cash to lower his bills. And there's already an in-state tuition reduction because of all the in-state subsidies. You add all that together, we are subsidizing higher education more than ever before.
Right. It's important to note that most of the people who are getting a significant tax credit will not have children who are eligible for Pell Grants. Those are generally two different pots of money. But you add them together and you're getting the overall subsidy for the institution.
At what point does this end? In that you might be saying there's more subsidy going there than ever, but I'm hearing from parents, oh my God, the tuition increases are killing me. Mm-hmm. Now, they are happy to get their $2,500 from the feds, or maybe their kids get Pell Grants and they're grateful for that, but they feel like it's not subsidized enough, mm-hmm. even though your shocking news that it's been subsidized now more than ever before.
Yeah. Well, I mean, there's a kind of logical endpoint to this. A larger and larger percentage of people's disposable income goes towards paying for higher education, and that can't continue indefinitely. You know, there's a kind of breaking point that has to happen economically where people just will not pay what they're being asked to pay anymore, and we're beginning to see some signs of that. Overall enrollment...
What kind of signs?
Well, for instance, overall enrollment in higher ed actually declined slightly the last couple of years. Now, that might be partially because the economy is improving and therefore the opportunity cost of going to school is becoming higher. You know, going to school is sort of counter-cyclical relative to the economy as a whole, because you know if you can't get a job, then
you might as well go to school.
And if the economy is better in terms of employment opportunities, and people take those rather than go to school. But leaving that aside, even so, there's some signs that people are beginning to resist really the cost of higher education that's being presented to them. This is especially true in the law school world where I work. There's been a massive decline in applicants to law school that's driven partially, I think, by just resistance to the enormous tuition rises.
Will there be some other sort of competition that comes and changes the system altogether? It's hard for me to believe that we all, carry around smartphones. Mm-hmm. We self-direct our entertainment with Netflix and Pandora and everything mm-hmm. else. We gather information and technology in different ways, but yet when it comes to getting our education, including our higher education, mm-hmm. we go massively into debt. We get student loans. We go to the big university on camp, that has all these different colleges and mm-hmm. schools. Does that change?
Well, I think it's going to.
Will there be an explosion and we're going to see 100 yeah. different little trade schools that pop up instead?
Well, it's a very interesting question as to what technology is going to do to higher ed. Is there going to be more distance learning? Is there going to be more online stuff? Probably so. The philosopher Alfred North Whitehead actually said 100 years ago, he said that the university has been obsolete since the invention of the printing press, which was obviously an exaggeration, and I don't believe that that's true at all. But there is a kernel of truth to that. And now, when basically every library in the world fits into your smartphone, essentially, people will, I think, find ways of being able to educate the young people without necessarily having the massive fixed capital costs that have been essentially part of the higher ed institution in the United States.
So let me see if I'm getting this. So we're spending more on the taxpayer side than we ever have before. We're spending more on the tuition side, which is the consumer side,
right.
than ever before. So it's really even hiding the full costs of how wildly expensive higher ed is. And if we took away the subsidies, we'd get a better sense of just how bloated this is. Why is it so bloated? Why is higher ed so remarkably expensive?
Well, there's an old saying in economics, if you subsidize something, you'll get more of it. And we've subsidized higher ed to an enormous degree, and we've gotten a lot more of it. Now, to the extent that higher ed is valuable because some people have it and some people don't, the more people have it, the less valuable it becomes as an economic phenomenon. That's a real...
Explain that a little bit.
Well, for example, suppose that the main value of a college degree is that it signals to employer that the person who has it is smart and hardworking. Well, that signal is valuable to the extent that somebody has it and somebody else doesn't. If everybody has it, then the signal has no value because it doesn't differentiate
We all have bachelor's degrees in humanities from the University of Colorado. We're applying for the same job. It doesn't differentiate us.
Right.
Whereas maybe 30, 40, 50 years ago, oh, this is a kid with a college degree.
Right.
Even though it's not in the area we need, it shows that he's got stick-to-itiveness, he was able to go through and get his classes, and so he can see something through.
Right, right. And that's the difference, that's what economists call a positional good. Right. If you and I are both hungry and there's like two ham sandwiches, then that's better than if there's one ham sandwich. But if there's you and I both need a job and we both have the same credentials and there's one job, then one of us is going to get it and the other isn't going to get it. And that's the problem with positional goods, and that's one of the problems with the higher ed explosion in the United States.
Give me some remedies here, because as a father who's looking to put a kid through school here pretty soon, this scares the hell out of me. I don't want to be on the hook on the tax side. I certainly don't want to be on the consumer side. What's the solution?
Well, I believe the solution is that we have to be realistic that we can't have an economy that is based on the only people who can have decent jobs are people with college degrees. That's just not going to work, because if everyone has to have a college degree, then a college degree isn't going to have value, and it's going to be way too expensive of an entry mechanism to get, you know, into the market for employment. And so what we have to do is, I think, focus on economic solutions that don't depend on the notion of expanding higher education, because expanding higher education, you know, has its limits, and I think we're running up against those limits as a practical matter.
What's on the other side of those limits, then?
Well, on the other side of those limits, I think, is a bubble that will pop, you know?
And a bunch of kids going, you know what, I'm going to keep my 100 grand and not go into debt, and I'm going to go start a career myself without going to see
you.
Yeah,
and especially parents who come to that conclusion themselves, and then, you know, like, that's what happens with bubbles. I mean, this was happened with, if you bought a house in Las Vegas in 2006, you know, 3 years later, it was worth like half as much as it was when you bought it.
And your college education might be worth the same thing.
Yeah.
Paul, thank you. You stay tuned.